can see this hierarchy. It's a bit convoluted. But yeah, the important part is that I'm from this rendering and modeling group. And yeah, as you can see, it's quite a large group. We have one full professor now, four postdocs, and 11 PhD students, including me. And we also have a small YouTube channel. You can see, for example, the rendering lecture. It's an extended version or improved version of what Karoi, so the guy from Two Minute Papers did previously. And there's also a nice introduction to Vulkan. Yeah, as Peter already said, I'm working mostly with Michi and also Stefan Ohallinger from the postdocs. And we are in cooperation with Nilo Mitra and Paul Guerrero. And this resulted in my first publication. So yeah, a bit more about me. Yeah, as Peter already said, I'm a PhD student. I'm currently in my fourth year. So it takes a bit longer than it's expected, but yeah, usual length, I would say. It was my first publication, but two more are in work, and I hope to finish in 1 or 2 years. My focus is on surface reconstruction using deep learning. So I'm basically just a lowly PhD student, and I feel very honored that you invited me. And as many academics people might know, you have always this issue with going from one limited contract to the next. And currently there's a bit a bad funding situation since the project proposal reviews were delayed. And you know, there's probably a solution, but it's not quite clear right now. So in case you know a company that wants to fund my PhD, please contact me. Yeah. And now let's get technical. So here are some applications that we can enable with the technology that I present today. So this first one is Kinect Fusion. It's a quite nice paper from 2011, I think. So you can imagine going with, for example, the Kinect around a scene, and you can get in real time, get the surface reconstructed. And then you can use this surface, for example, for AR applications, let balls rain on the surface and they will bounce correctly, or you can get augmented reality and place objects that are correctly occluded by the real scene objects. Another application is this one. So just an example from capturing reality. They use the drone to fly around in a environment to scan it. And with several techniques, you can get really high quality assets that you can use, for example, for games or even movies. Sometimes you need some manual processing afterwards, but the quality can be really good with these techniques. So that's for the motivation. So this presentation will have several parts. So I'll start with geometry representations, then go through several methods, and finally show with how to evaluate it. And in the end, I present the code of my work of the points to serve. And yeah, that's it. So let's start with geometry representations. So we have several options here, namely point clouds, images, and implicit and explicit surfaces. And let's start simple with images. So usually it's 2D data in a grid. But you can also have it as vector graphics, for example. But let's assume for this lecture that we have 2D grid data, RGB, so three color channels, and usually you have stored it as a byte, so three bytes per pixel. And you can imagine this scales quadratically with the resolution. So you can get quite easily a lot of data, and that can be hard to deal with, especially since basically everyone can capture this kind of data with a smartphone, and even a cheap smartphone camera has a full HD resolution, for example, and you can get even more data simply from the internet, like Google image search, and you can instantly find hundreds or thousands of images of specific objects, at least if they are famous in some way. But still you can get some issues. For example, if you imagine the roof of this church, it doesn't have too many photos. So you have quite sparse data for some parts and possibly very dense data for other parts. You also have a lot of redundancy in all those images, but you need it for certain applications, for certain algorithms. So that might be an advantage, actually. So another property of images is that you have every kind of scene information essentially baked into the pixels. So for example, lighting information, information about the surface of the objects, and of course geometry. And since it's baked into the pixels, it's very hard to disassemble them. And a lot of the algorithms that we talk about today are aiming at this kind of disassembly. You can have spatial neighborhood estimations. So you have, for example, a simple edge detection in this kind of data, and get gradients. And often you have RGB data in combination with depth data, so RGBD, which is essentially like a part of a point cloud. And point cloud is the next kind of geometry representation. So in this case, it's a point cloud rendering using Portree of my colleague Markus Schütz. He is the guy behind Portree, in case you know it. And this point cloud is basically the same geometry, represents the same stuff. But in this case, it's actually a different scan, so it's not reconstructed from the images. Point clouds are usually very large. So you have often millions or billions of points. And with some renderers, you can even render them in real time. For example, as I said, with Portree, and even in a browser. So a point cloud essentially is just a collection of points, but they might have different properties. So in professional point clouds, you have, of course, you have position, you have usually color, you have in many cases normals, but you can also have, for example, reflection strength or the heat number of laser rays. You can often capture them directly with certain scanners, for example, a LiDAR scanner mounted on a vehicle, as I showed in the beginning with the Kinect, it's similar, it's RGBD, but it's easy to convert them to point clouds. Point clouds have this property that it's not easy to get neighborhood information as in images. So for example, nearest neighbor queries are very inefficient if you use a naive approach. If you use special acceleration structures like org tree, KD tree, then it's much faster, but it's still some effort. It doesn't come for free. And you don't have continuous information in point cloud. there are some cases where you don't have normals explicitly captured by the scanner, but since you have captured a point, you always know that the surface must face the camera. So you have at least the rough direction of the normal. And even if you don't want or can't do this rough estimation, there are some techniques where you can estimate normals quite nicely. So for example, the PCPNet was some older techniques. So point clouds come with different kinds of artifacts usually. So as you can see here, different types of artifacts. Very common is the non-uniform sampling. So it's actually very hard to not have this kind of artifact since, well, you have some kind of surface, and when you have the scanner somewhere, you still have some kind of a slanted angle, for example. Or when it's curved, of course you have non-uniform sampling. Then when you're dealing with points from the real world, you always have some kind, some sort of noise in the data, which comes from, for example, just physical effects or software side effects, quantization, for example, or float arithmetics can just be one reason. It depends, of course.
Cut off the last two sentences we didn't hear, if you can repeat.
I can hear you, but it's a bit stuttering.
Hello, hello. Can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you now.
Yeah, so I think, I don't know if the other people in the audience, but I missed the last two sentences you were explaining. If you can repeat them.
About the non-uniform sampling?
Yeah, I think after that, it broke off a bit.
Okay, yeah, I'll repeat it. Okay, so this non-uniform sampling is a sort of artifact on point clouds that you can't really avoid. It happens naturally when you have a scanner at some point, and for example, a curved surface. And the noisy data is also hard to avoid when you're dealing with real world scans, simply because of physics. There's always some kind of noise and inaccuracy in the scanners, but it can also come from the software side, for example, from quantization or float arithmetics. Then there are outliers in many real-world scans. It can be, for example, a bird flying over a house while this house is being scanned. And this bird can be hit several times at different positions by the same scanner. So you sometimes need to deal with this kind of problem. And in many cases, you have multiple scans. For example, when you want to scan a house, you need to place your scanner at different places around this house and then need to combine the point clouds of each scan. So you need some kind of alignment, like this iterative closest points. That's a very popular algorithm. And with that, you can combine the point clouds, but since it's an optimization process, it might still leave some kind of error. So especially when you try to combine scans of repeating features like a house facade with many windows, then it's very hard to get a proper alignment of the scans. And finally, there might be missing data simply because someone forgot to place the scanner at a specific point. Or when you have curved surfaces, it's very common that you have scan shadows just because the ray of the scanner couldn't hit the surface or because it was occluded by some other part. And so this kind of problems can lead to very strong reconstruction errors. Like in this case, it's a Poisson reconstruction and we are missing some points due to scan shadows. And this algorithm just blows up the reconstruction. So long story short, the quality of the input data is always important. And certain algorithms can deal better with certain types of artifacts. Okay, let's move on to the next geometry representation.
I have a quick question.
Okay.
If you go to the previous slide.
Yes.
So why in the absence of any data points would the algorithm predict, it seems like some surface? Why wouldn't it just, can you explain?
Yeah, I'll explain this algorithm a bit more in detail later anyway. But it essentially predicts the surface based on this normal information. And there are normals missing, so it needs to fill in some kind of information. And this filling in leads to this kind of blow up. Is this accurate enough?
Yeah, I just was wondering why does it need to? I guess there's many different ways of filling in information, and one is just maybe not fill in information. I guess this is a specific question. We can move on.
But it's it's an important point. If you have, or it would be important to recognize if your data is missing or if your data is wrong, for example, and deal with it. This specific algorithm doesn't really deal with it, but you can use some other, like just connect the surrounding next six vertices or points to vertices and create faces. Then you would run into not this kind of problem, so you would get a hole, but it would probably construct some very ugly faces. It's a matter of algorithm. Okay. Then let's move on to explicit surfaces. I'm not sure how many of you are into computer graphics.
I think most of us are.
Good. So then that's probably not really new for you. That's just a common representation.
We have a request here from Remy. You're now talking with the speakers of your computer. If you have like a microphone or something, maybe, because we hear an echo. Actually, it's a good remark.
Okay.
Yeah.
Maybe it's just the room.
No, if that's what it is, it's okay. If we can add, like, if you have a small microphone to use, it could be more comfortable.
It's my best microphone and the camera.
Okay.
Okay. But I hope it's okay.
It's good enough. We can understand.
Okay. Yeah. So this is one of the very simple representations of explicit surfaces. So you essentially have a list of vertices with coordinates in space, and you have a list of faces. And for each face, you know which vertex belongs to it. And from that, you can, you have enough information for rendering, for example. You can also have more advanced data structures, like, for example, the swinged edge data structure, or the half edge data structure, where you have information of neighboring parts of the mesh. And yeah, you have easy queries of elements. And you can use it, for example, for geometry processing. Okay, and this brings us to the last geometry representation. This is implicit surfaces, as it is, for example, used also in Kinect Fusion. You can see here this cross section of the scene. So this essentially gives you a layer in a 2D grid, or a layer of a 3D grid, which is a 2D grid. And at every voxel in this grid, you have the information of what's the distance to the next surface point. And if you're inside this object, then it's negative, but it's a convenience, so to say, but you could swap it. Outside, it's usually positive, which means that when you're at the zero set of pixels, that is your surface. So it's most important to have this surface region correct. Further away from the surface, it's sufficient to just have the sign of the sign distance. So that is quite common that you have truncated sign distance functions, which means if the value is less than minus one, or greater than plus one, then you can just clamp it and save some space. You can represent this kind of data also as a function of x, y, z, for example. And SDFs are very clean, so it's essentially impossible to get a messy topology, which is very common with explicit representations. You can interpolate between the grid cells, but the grid itself, of course, has a limited accuracy. And it has a very high memory requirement. You can improve it with an octree, but it's still very heavy on memory. And if you take only the sign of this SDF, that's then called occupancy. And this will play a role in several applications and several algorithms later. Okay, so this concludes the first part about geometry representations. Do we have questions? Something in the chat?
I didn't see anything.
Okay, good. We will have chances later anyway. Okay, then let's move on to the methods part. So don't worry, you don't need to read those things. I think there's something new. Neural representations. Yeah, there were quite some interesting publications in the recent time. There was one that they essentially overfitted on one object and used it, for example, for a level of detail. That was really interesting. I think it's not yet in normal applications, but it has a lot of potential, I think. Yeah, so you're welcome. Okay, so about the methods. So we will go through many of those. This is a whole research field with thousands of publications. Some of those conversions, so essentially those are conversions between different representations. Some of those require special properties of the input data. So for example, if you want to get signed distances from a mesh, then this mesh needs to be very clean. So for example, it doesn't have, must not have self-intersections, it should be watertight. If it's not a very clean mesh, then you need a quite complicated heuristic or a complicated algorithm to deal with those input data. But on the other hand, some conversions give you guarantees for the output. For example, a reconstruction algorithm might give you a guarantee that the reconstruction error does not exceed a certain value. So, but for now, let's focus on the typical scanning pipeline. So the photogrammetry pipeline, in which we have images as the raw input, then we apply structure for motion and or, depending on the case, multi-view stereo. Then we apply Poisson reconstruction to get an implicit surface and finally turn this implicit surface into an explicit surface using matching cubes so that we can use it, for example, for rendering. Of course, we could also render an implicit surface, but that's not as efficient as you would want it for games, for example. So, and on to the first part of this pipeline, which is structure for motion and multi-view stereo. And here is a video. So, come on. So this is a video from the publication that belongs to CoilMap. CoilMap is an open source photogrammetry tool. It's very popular actually. And here in this example, they used 21,000 input images. And the output of structure for motion is a sparse point cloud. And you can see in this example quite nicely what means this amount of images and what means a sparse point cloud in this case. So you can also see that when you don't have anyone taking a photo from a certain angle, then you don't have points in this point cloud at this place. So there's a rule of thumb for the photos that you should have. So for example, you should avoid textureless objects like white walls. You should have similar illumination conditions for all photos, which is of course very hard to get in the outside world. And you should have some visual overlaps or some redundancy between the photos. So the rule of thumb, each object or each point should be seen in at least three images. This also means that you need some kind of trade-off between this necessary overlap and redundancy. Because if you have too much data, the algorithm just takes too long. And you should have the same camera for all photos and the same settings or properties of the camera. But if you don't have those photos and those requirements, then you can still get some results, but you will have a bit larger error. And there are again several algorithms that might be better for those kinds of error.
We have a question here. Were the photo perspectives annotated?
No. No, they're not. That's the main part of this algorithm to get the position of the photos in the 3D space. Mm-hmm. And that's actually the slide. So in CoreMap, they use this incremental SFM pipeline. So you start by trying to find the best two views. The best two views means you should start in a dense region, which means that this fitting is more robust, but it's also slower. Then the next step is to triangulate those feature points. And then you repeat the following steps for each other view. So you need to localize the camera in the point cloud. And then you choose the next camera, which is observing the most points that you already have captured, that you already know in the reconstruction. And then you can triangulate new feature points from this new camera viewpoint. And in the end, also for each view, you can do this bundle adjustment where you try to minimize the reprojection error. So if you imagine you have you have at least two rays that should hit one point in the 3D space, but due to several kinds of error, they won't really hit one point. So this bundle adjustment tries to merge two points, two estimated hit points or more in one point. And then hopefully this merge point is more accurate. And there are also global versions that try to handle all viewpoints at once. So this is, SFM is on its own field of research. So it's a bit hard to go into much detail here. There's one very important aspect. So for the key point detection in the photos, you need key points. And a very common algorithm for this is the scale invariant feature transform, SIFT. But you can also use SURF and many more. For SIFT, you can get a feature descriptor for every pixel, but most of them won't be really descriptive. So if you have, for example, corners in the image, then this SIFT feature will be very descriptive, and you will have an easier time finding this exact descriptor in a different image at the same place. So like corners on buildings, those are quite good to match with SIFT. There are still a lot of errors usually when you use this kind of matching. And then you can deal with it mostly, for example, by using RANSAC, like this random sampling and consensus. Feature descriptors, this already sounds a lot like machine learning, deep learning. And indeed, there is a lot of research going on that tries to find features or tries to do this matching for SFM. So that's still a very active field of research. So then let's move on to multi-view stereo. So this is a bit similar to structure for motion, but here, come on. Again, a video. The input here is, it depends on the algorithm. There are many different variants of multi-view stereo. But in this example, which is also included in CoreMap, you have a sparse point cloud as input. and you get a dense point cloud as output. You can see here in this video the difference between the densities. Okay, and there's again a lot of variants of this algorithm. Here it's patch-based multi-view stereo. And the rough overview of this algorithm is that you have three steps. You have this initial feature matching, then you have expansion, which is done multiple times, and also filtering. For the initial feature matching, you have again key point detection. It's a bit older algorithm, so I think there was no SIFT at this point of time. So they're using the difference of Gaussians and Harris operator to get the key points. Then there's again a triangulation step. And in this expansion step, they try to grow from those patches that you triangulated into neighboring empty cells in your reconstruction. And yeah, you essentially grow those patches multiple times. And then you try to get many or as dense as possible information in your output, but it's also very prone to outliers and errors. So there's this filtering step where you essentially check if this point that you found in one reconstruction view is actually visible from this viewpoint. So this visibility check then should filter a lot of those outliers. And again, there are several steps in this algorithm that could be and are being improved with machine learning. Okay, so that's it for this first conversion step. Now we have a dense or more or less dense point cloud, and we use Poisson reconstruction to get an implicit surface.
Just a quick question about the visibility step. If you could, the check visibility, yeah. If you could explain a bit how it's done. I know it's introduction, but still, it's interesting to hear.
Yeah, that's actually not so much my field of expertise. So, but I hope I can explain a bit. So you have those points of, let's say this red point, which corresponds to this red patch. And you see it in multiple of those views for the reconstruction. Mm-hmm. And it might be that actually this red patch is not visible from this camera, but from those. So you have this projected point, but you can't actually see it because, let's say, the blue patch is actually in front of the red one. Mm-hmm. So this red point should not appear in this grid, in this reconstruction. Mm-hmm. And if you triangulate this, this point would not play a role anymore. So the accuracy of those reconstructed points would be, would have a larger impact. Mm-hmm.
Thank you. And also Amit had a question. Sparse PC, if you can explain a bit more what you mean, or Philippe, if you understand it, if you can explain to us what he means in his question.
I meant to ask, COMA produces a sparse point cloud, but you mentioned that at the end of the stage, what we need is a dense point cloud. So how do you get to a dense point cloud from COMA?
No, so COMAP is a whole library or several steps, several processing steps. And the first step is the structure for motion, which gives you a sparse point cloud. And the second step that's usually used, but it's more or less optional, that's the multi-view stereo, and that converts a sparse point cloud into a dense point cloud.
I see. I thought those were two different approaches, but they're sequential. Yeah. Got it. Thank you.
Yeah, it depends. There are a lot of different variants of both algorithms, and you can use them essentially independent from each other. There are different kinds that have different input data, different output data. So let's say multi-view stereo is a category of processing that tries to get from images to dense data, I would say, or from point clouds.
Got it. Thank you.
Okay, so I think we can move on to Poisson reconstruction. So this is a very popular algorithm, especially in the improved version. It's also implemented in MeshLab, so very easy to use for normal people. And it's more or less a standard for reconstruction. So the basic idea of this algorithm is that it solves a Poisson equation for oriented points to reconstruct a surface. So focus is on oriented points. So you need the normal information for each point. And it might have larger errors if your normals are just a bit off. And you will have very strong errors, as I showed in the beginning with those artifacts, when the normals are flipped, for example, which might happen in some estimation cases, for example. So the first step here is this oriented point cloud. Then it has this gradient of the indicator function. So you have this function on the for the Poisson equation. And this is a vector field. It's zero almost everywhere, but it gives you the inside-outside direction at the surface. And you can turn this indicator gradient into the indicator function so that you have zero outside and one inside, and also everywhere in a grid, for example. And then you can reconstruct the surface from this function because you can sample the grid at any point. So you have the surface at least at the accuracy of the grid resolution. And for the surface, you can use 0.5, but it's very flexible. So you can basically use any ISO value that appears in this indicator function. With that, you can see here an example. So on the left is the input, the point cloud from the armadillo. In the middle, you have this indicator function. And on the right, that's a reconstructed object with the cutting plane. And there is an improved version of it. It's called screen Poisson surface reconstruction. They use a screening term to improve the accuracy of this algorithm. And you can see here the comparison of both. And you can see that the improved version, so the blue line, is much more accurate. So it, I would say it deals better with a varying density of the points. Good, but it also has a downside. So you can see here, there is missing information on the bottom of the head. And Poisson reconstruction, it filled the hole, basically. But the improved version, so the screened Poisson reconstruction, has this kind of blow up that I showed before with the artifacts. So, well, there is missing information and the screening term goes nuts, basically. Yeah, and that brings us to the last conversion step. So from implicit surface converting to explicit surface. Again, there are a lot of different algorithms that you could use. In this case, I will present matching cubes, at least roughly. Although Poisson reconstruction actually uses a different method that is hierarchical. So it works on an octree, I think, but it has a similar approach with the same cases. So here, marching cubes. Well, you go through the grid of SDF values. Come on. You process it cell by cell, and the sign of those SDF values at the corners gives you a specific case. So you have 2^8 cases of inside-outside configurations, and you can look it up in this lookup table. So this configuration gives you an 8-bit bit field, and that's the index for the lookup table. And an entry could look like this. So you have you know then which vertices need to be connected to form faces. And sometimes you don't need as many vertices. And there is an interpolation step, because along the edge, you have 2 SDF values and you can interpolate between them to determine where the vertex will be created. This gives you a result like this. And again, there are many different variants of matching cubes or in general contouring algorithms. Some give you guarantees for the output. For example, the variant by Levina is very common, or also implemented in many libraries like SciPy. Yeah, SciPy was it, I think, or sklearn. SK image, there are different libraries. Different algorithms.
Philip, is there a place where we can find the different reconstruction algorithms or the different libraries that do contouring? Like a list somewhere or something accessible for us to? Because also there was a question, in the chat about this. What are the various algorithms?
I don't really know about the list. I think you just need to go to Google Scholar, Google it. the typical marching cubes and the Levina variation are very common. So you can find them in many libraries.
Maybe after the talk, if you could, like the list that you know, like the algorithms that you know and can recommend, just send it over and we could publish it. Because me also, I sometimes look for these and I see in the audience somebody else asked for the same thing.
Okay. So those are the basic cases. Some variants have slightly different cases, but it's usually almost the same. And this brings us to the end of the typical reconstruction pipeline. I will now go through several specific algorithms that I found interesting. So the next one is my own, points to serve. And that's a neural network that turns a point cloud into a signed distance field. And for this, you need to know what's a neural network. I mean, it's probably not too much new for most of you in the group, but still, need to share audio. I hope you can hear.
Backpropagation is a supervised learning algorithm used for training. Deep learning model. This learning method is the most popular at the moment because it makes possible the use of powerful calculation methods with low computation time. In a deep learning model, we use the parameters to calculate the usage proportion of each neurons to get an expected output. Training a model means teaching it which parameters to use to successfully get the right output. With the use of backpropagation, the model will change its parameters, called weights, to achieve the expected output. It changes its parameters by calculating the difference between the expected output and the actual output, called the error. The backpropagation algorithm is simple to understand. At first, we send an example, like a picture of a cat, to the model. Since the model is not trained yet, we don't know which weights to use and not use. We have to initialize the weights to some random value. But now we get an output, dog, instead of the expected output, cat. The model calculates the difference between the results for cat and the results that got us dog. This is the error. It then propagates this error backward to the model, updating all the weights in proportion to the error. After doing so, another example is fed to the model and we repeat the process all over again, until the error is minimized and the model is trained. Once the error becomes minimum, your model is ready to work with new unseen data.
Okay, so that's just a brief overview. I guess most of you already know it a bit more in detail. This is just because this course is part of our modeling course at the university. And we can't expect at that point that people, computer graphics people, know neural networks. Okay, but I think we have again questions.
Yeah, the sound was very peculiar, very unique to our field of deep learning.
Yeah.
Very National Geographic oriented, let's say.
Big fan, big fan.
Okay, so let's start with my own research. So this points to serve, which we published at ECCV 2020, and it also got a spotlight spot. So as I said, it's a neural network that converts a point cloud to an SDF. And then we use matching cubes to turn this SDF into a mesh. So to start, we need a query point, like this red point here. And we have a surface, so this light gray surface, and it's sampled with some noise. And for this query point, we take a local subsample, which is, for example, the 300 nearest neighbors of this query point. This gives us a local prior, which can be learned from this local subsample. And that's independent from shape types. So it's generalized across classes. So we can handle cars and planes with the same model. But we also need the inside-outside information, for which we need a global subsample. But this can be quite quite sparse. And with this, we have the information, so the absolute distance to the surface, and also the sign of the sign distance. And here again, so this is the architecture of the network. We have the query point, we get the two subsamples. Then we have the QSTN, so Quaternion Spatial Transformer Network from PCPNet, which gives us a quaternion that tries to rotate the point clouds to a canonical pose. It later turned out that this actually doesn't really help so much, but it increases the complexity of the network. So I would now advise not to use the QSTN. Still, we in this case, we had then applied this quaternion to the point clouds, rotate them. Then we put the two resulting point clouds into point transformers. So those are very similar to PointNet. And then we get two feature vectors. We can just concatenate the two feature vectors, also add the query point. It's actually not needed because it's centered at, so both subsets are centered at the query point, which means that the query point is always at the origin of the coordinate system. So we can actually omit that. But still we need and we have the two feature vectors from the two subsamples and put them into a multi-layer perceptron. And this MLP gives us two flows. One is essentially the sign or a probability for the sign to be inside or outside. And the other one is a regression part that gives us the absolute distance to the surface. The reason for this split is that the sign is much more difficult for the network to learn. And classification, so essentially we turn this sign estimation into a classification problem, which is easier to learn for the network. And then we do some post-processing to the sign and to the absolute distance. And then we can just multiply them and get our final sign distance for this query point. And this also means that we need to do this evaluation of the neural network many times to get a grid of SDF values. Apparently I didn't include the slides, but well, that would be much too long, many evaluations. It would take like 2 days for one reconstruction. So we have this heuristic that we only evaluate grid cells that are near the point cloud, and then try to fill in the sign of the SDF with using a box filter multiple times. Okay, let's go on to a different neural network, which is AtlasNet. I like this one because it's one of the rare rare algorithms that directly turn a point cloud into an explicit surface. So it's actually called papier-mâché approach to learning 3D surface generation. Don't know why the name AtlasNet stuck. It learns those patches, so parts of small meshes from a point cloud, and then it wraps those patches onto the surface of the object, which also means that your reconstruction is very messy. You have a completely broken topology and you would need a lot of post-processing cleaning to get a 3D printable object of it. but you have it quite easy to get a textured output. Okay, and then let's move on to a different approach. This is differentiable rendering. It's a tool essentially like deep learning, and it has also a similar structure. You have inputs like scene parameters, materials, lights, geometry, cameras. You throw all those parameters into the render and get a rendering output with a lot of additional information that you wouldn't need usually, because usually you only want the rendered image, but you also get, for example, depth information, and you can also get silhouettes, discontinuities, everything. Then you have an objective function, which is essentially like a loss function for deep learning, which needs a ground truth object. And then you can pass, but since this rendering process is differentiable in this case, you can pass the errors back through the scene, through the rendering to the scene parameters. And then you can update the scene parameters to get a closer match of the ground truth data. And here's a nice example. Come on. Which is made, among others, from Wenzel Jakob. You might know him from Mitsuba. And this is part of Mitsuba 2. So you can see here how this, how the geometry is updated many times to get closer to this render target. So it's like deep learning and optimization process that has millions of iterations. And also this differentiable rendering is one of the hottest topics, hottest fields of research that we currently have in graphics. So I included it in a project proposal. Okay. One last example. Okay, and this concludes the second part about methods. And I think we again have a question. Yeah, so Atlas is probably referring to texture atlases, but I don't know why it's called, or why we call the network AtlasNet, although the paper is the paper mache approach. Maybe it was somewhere in the code. Okay, do we have more questions about this part? Anyone still here?
No, the people are here, but no questions for now.
Okay, no problem. Then we come to the third part, so about evaluation. So how do we actually know if one reconstruction method is better than another method? There are a lot of different metrics that we can use. And the first one is quite simple. It's visual quality. So actually, well, you can say, I don't have a mathematical metric for this. So please look at it and maybe agree with me that the new version is better. So when you have a focus on aesthetics, for example. So this is the teaser image from Points to Serve. you can easily see that our method has better results at the holes. Why isn't rendering time a evaluation stat? For the parameter inputs earlier?
Well, I guess my point overall is that if all we're doing is focusing on the evaluation of whether things fit, right, to, you know, your test data set, we really don't understand how does the algorithm, how quick is the algorithm? Like, how can it be incorporated into other stacks? If it takes 10 days versus maybe 2 hours, then it's a huge trade-off, I would say. So I was just wondering, has the community been kind of tracking evaluation time? I mean, sorry, rendering time in general, or is that just something that is pretty much omitted in papers?
You mean for the differential rendering?
Yeah, forgive me, I don't really have a background in this, but I would assume rendering to be, in this case, like fitting the point clouds to a surface.
The rendering itself is an offline rendering method, but this optimization process is not so much about the rendering itself, it's more about the inputs for the rendering. So they update the geometry, but the rendering process itself stays the same. Don't know which kind of renderer it is, but I assume they have a more or less fixed number of samples per pixel that they render. So the rendering time will be the same almost.
Maybe I'll add here, what we're comparing when we're comparing reconstruction techniques is how good are you able to reconstruct the 3D structure, not necessarily show it on a screen, which is the rendering. So when you do rendering, you have a 3D structure and you try to show it on a monitor. This is not what's being compared across these different research. Philip, by the way, correct me if I'm wrong, right? So rendering it, it's just for us to see what's happening more than anything. The structure already exists.
No. Okay. The structure does not exist, and not in the beginning.
No. So, after training, like when we're evaluating quality of reconstruction.
Got it. Okay. Thanks for the clarification. Yeah. Wrong term here. But I guess then have people been tracking optimization time? So like how long does it take to
optimize
of the algorithms, like a general benchmarking of its time performance?
Actually that was a quite a big part in my paper. From what I've seen, the time to reconstruct a certain object is usually included, but it's a short part in the paper. So if I remember correctly, AtlasNet was like a few seconds per object. Points to surface quite slow, takes around 8 minutes with this optimization. Poisson reconstruction, of course, depends on the settings with everything. But Poisson reconstruction is a few seconds, but if you need to estimate normals, then it also takes a while. Does this answer your question?
Yeah, that's a general overview. Thank you very much.
Okay. So back to quality metrics. So visual quality, just looking at it, it's more about aesthetics, but in many cases, this is also a nice teaser image for your paper. Then the next one, more statistics thing for classification usually. So you have those metrics of recall, precision, F1 score, which I used, that's quite common. And in case you need an example, you can feel free to use this one. So this was actually an experiment of extended points to preserve classification in 2D. And also those metrics are interesting for machine learning because they sort of give you an alternative to loss function and you can detect overfitting possibly. So here you have different runs and you have the test metrics on the top and training metrics on the bottom, more or less aligned. So no overfitting going on here. Then we have the root mean square error, which we can use for many different things. This is an example from PCPNet, where they estimated normals for point clouds. And they calculate the error between the predicted normals and the ground truth normals. And you can get this error for every single normal, which you can then encode in this kind of visualization. Or you can take the mean of the root square error to get one number per object or one number for an entire data set possibly, and can show with this single number how good your algorithm is. Then what I again used in points to serve is a distance metric. So for each point on the surface, we calculate the distance to the ground truth surface. Where each point is actually not completely true because this would be an infinite number of points. So we sample both surfaces to get two sets of points. And then we can find the nearest neighbor of a point in one set to the closest point in a different set. And this gives us then the color at a specific point on the reconstruction. And we can again turn this distance metric into a single number for one object usually. This is then often the chamfer distance, which you can see here. So this is essentially a correspondence problem between two sets of points. And we try to find, in practice, we just take the closest point of each point in one set to the other set, take their distance, and then sum all those distances. So this gives us one single number that essentially represents the overall deviation of the reconstruction from the ground truth mesh. You can use it also as a loss function. I've seen this in one paper, but they had very small resolutions for the reconstruction. So I assume that it's a bit too slow, too much effort to really use it for a loss function. And finally, there is also curvature, in this case, discrete curvatures on meshes. And you can also compare the curvature of the reconstructed mesh with the curvature on the ground truth mesh, which again can give, for example, a root mean square error. And you can do it on Gaussian curvature or, for example, also on the principal curvature directions. So this brings us to the end, which leaves us with one main question, which is, which kind of method would you use for which kind of task? And well, the answer is, it depends. It depends on many parts, many aspects, for example, speed, do you need it real time? Then, of course, you wouldn't use points to serve, but DeepSDF could work, for example, or whatever is used in Kinect Fusion. It depends on the accuracy. So if you want to reconstruct objects that are used in games or movies, then you, of course, you want to have high accuracy and speed doesn't really matter. Then points to serve could be an option, but it also has some problems, as I mentioned, with the heuristic. This actually leads to some nasty effects when you have scan shadows or wrong estimations of the network. And those sign propagation, those leads to very ugly artifacts. So in many cases, it's probably best to use green Poisson surface reconstruction. And as I also said a few times, you need normals for green Poisson surface reconstruction. You don't need normals for points to serve. And then you have a decision to make. You can if you don't have normals, then you can still estimate them, for example, with PCPNet, but this introduces new errors, and then it's not so clear if Poisson reconstruction or points to serve is better. But for most applications, I would recommend Poisson reconstruction. And hopefully in a few months, I can present the extended version of points to serve, which will solve many issues because it will replace the stupid heuristic and sign propagation. And we'll make it hopefully much more accurate and also probably a bit faster. Okay, so then that's it for the evaluation part. And if you have questions, please ask. Otherwise, I would go on and present the points to serve code.
I have a quick question. So does anybody look at taking a 3D object and converting it into point clouds? So it's like the deconstruction?
Okay. Yeah, that's actually part of my dataset generation. So I will show you something in the code then. There are some approaches. So it's very easy. For example, you can turn a mesh into a point cloud just by throwing away the face information. So you have vertices. It's probably not very useful. You can sample on the surface, just picking a random face, picking a random point on the face, and then do it a million times, and you also have a point cloud. That's, as far as I know, used for a lot of machine learning reconstruction data sets. And what I used is a simulated scanner called Blensor, and that also simulates realistic noise, for example, and scan shadows.
Does anybody try and think about tying in the weights? So you have like a reconstructor and a deconstructor. Reconstruction from point cloud to surface, right? And then surface to point cloud, and you alternate them. So it's like a hybrid approach, I suppose. Has anybody looked into combining deconstruction and reconstruction in that way, I suppose?
Not that I'm aware of. I mean, it sounds a bit like if you would do the differentiable rendering, but not from a mesh. But you could use, for example, differentiable rendering with points plotting, so directly rendering points. So you would have a rendering of those points can compared to a ground truth and get the reconstruction.
Yeah, it's like, it's kind of like running two algorithms. You reconstruct and then you measure the error, I suppose, and then you deconstruct and you measure the error. And so then it's like a, in a it just provides you two, I guess, sources of error. Yeah.
Maybe I'll ask about the deconstruction part. It's a deterministic process, usually.
Yes. So, it depends. You can have some noise.
Yeah, like, but many times it is deterministic because you want to follow and you want to replicate it many times. So measuring error in the deconstruction part, for me, I can't see the benefit. I can tell when in some texture reconstruction works that I've seen with small training data sets, they do exactly that. So they train a network on a small data set to reconstruct texture, they render it, and then they have new images for that same texture and they added to the training set. And the more you train and the more you add the images to the training set, the better the accuracy is. That's like that. So the interesting part here is measuring again the reconstruction error, but you just enlarge your training set. This is what the deconstruction helps you with. Other than that, I don't think I've seen research that focuses on it, that doesn't focus on enlarging the training set. That's the thing.
Right. Okay. That's fair enough. Fair enough. That's mm-hmm. a good point.
Well, this could also be interesting because for certain things, we don't have too much training data for specific objects. Could be interesting.
Yeah, another interesting thing here, sorry I'm interrupting, but this is actually an interesting topic. So another interesting thing here is if you train a generative network to create new types of objects, and then you can also start enlarging your training set. You have a couple of works that do 3D reconstruction where they cut the network in the middle and there is an implicit field there, not a 3D implicit field, but a neural network implicit field. Mm-hmm. And then you generate new vectors for this field, fake vectors that can represent an object. And then you have a bigger training set to start working with. I don't remember if I've seen something used with this to improve reconstruction though. Sorry, Arthur, I was like, got me on a top.
No, it's really cool. I'm really geeking out about that. I guess just to continue this, I mean, like, so the deconstruction. So let's say it's a partially observable scene, right? I think there would be an error to deconstruction. It wouldn't be a deterministic function because you're estimating points that you can't see. And so why would you do that? Like, why would you? I think maybe one line of research that I think will be opening up in the future is building in a lot of redundancy in algorithms. So having kind of convergent metrics on the same task. And you say, okay, well, why would you do that? Like, why? I just think compute is going to decrease. It's just kind of, I think, where it's going. GPUs will increase their power. Algorithm classes will be opened up. And so then maybe redundancy is a cool thing versus like seeing it as inefficiency. So I guess some of the inspiration is that I think the human mind is pretty redundant in how we think about objects. It's just loose inspiration, but I think that's kind of where my mind goes.
Mm-hmm. Good. Any more questions, comments? It doesn't seem like it. Then I would go on to the code intro, introduction. Mm-hmm. Okay, so everything is online. It's on GitHub. You can find it. I think it was also in the description of this event.
Correct.
We have download scripts for models and training data. What is not directly included is the raw input data set, because for points to serve, I use the ABC data set. So that's a collection of 1 million CAD objects. it's online. You can download it directly from them. And I just used a tiny subset of those and applied several processing steps. I can show you now. Okay, so when you pull the code, you will get this all this information, all those files. And you will also get a minimal data set for just running all this stuff. In this minimal data set, you will have three objects, two for training, one for evaluation and testing. So this is one of the objects from ABC. It's scaled, it passed my filter. So even though the data set consists of CAD objects, they need to be triangulated. So I downloaded the triangulated version. And this apparently introduced some errors, so like in 1% or 5% of the objects. So some of them have safe intersections or are somehow not watertight. And I need to filter them, get rid of them. And then for machine learning, I scale those meshes to unit cube size so that machine learning has a specific domain size, let's say. And this mesh is now the input for some processing steps. So for the Point Cloud Sampler, for example. And the Point Cloud Sampler, as I said, it's Blenser. Gives such a point cloud. You can see it has a lot of noise. So it's actually quite a strong noise for many examples in my work. And also here you can see my cursor, right?
Yes, we can see.
Okay, so you can see here scan shadows. That's important for the reconstruction because reconstruction without scan shadows is quite simple. but with scan shadows, you have a neural network that sort of has an idea how a closed object should look like. So it can more or less fill in this kind of information. So this point cloud is then the input. See, it's around 60K points. So it's quite tiny compared to reconstruction from landscapes, for example. And that's probably a reason why points to serve doesn't work so well with large point clouds. And then we need for the training SDF samples, which look like this. So we have 10% of the samples in the unit cube randomly uniform distributed, and we have also inside the object samples, of course, because we need inside and outside. And we also have more, did I take the correct thing? I think it's wrongly rotated or whatever. Anyway, there are 80% of the samples close to the surface. It's inside-outside decision is quite easy, far away from the surface, so we focus the samples on the surface. So that's what this training set more or less looks like. So those are visualizations. The actual training data is in NumPy arrays, so it's compressed. Also the query points and SDF values, ground truth SDF values are NumPy arrays. Then we have this settings file, which gives us parameters for the dataset generation. So for example, number of scans, so the number of scans is a bit random. We give a minimum and a maximum, and also minimum and maximum for the noise strength of the scanner. We have pre-text files, test set and evaluation set is here the same. And that's just a list of mesh names. So far for data sets, here are download scripts for different data sets that I used in the paper. There are a few differences between the sets. So some sets, or one set is mostly for training, also for evaluation and testing. And there are several other data sets that are only for evaluation, so for the paper. And then there are small data sets that are not created from meshes, but directly from point clouds. So it's basically skipping most of the processing pipeline just to give a point cloud input for the network, which also means that we don't have a ground truth for such data sets. Good, then let's have a look at the code. A bit more about the folder structure. So we have here experiment scripts. So those are meant to reproduce the results from the paper. They keep track of the parameters that I use. Maybe you know it, that you do some experiment, tweak a parameter here and there, and you get a result. And when you come back a week later, you don't remember which parameter you used for a certain result. So that's why I fix them with those scripts. Images is just for the README, the teaser image. In logs, we have the logs from TensorBoard. So to get the loss curves, models, again, with download scripts. And this has, for example, the vanilla model with parameters and optional description. And then we have results, which is probably the most interesting part. And here the reconstruction. So I've ran the code earlier, and it's a very tiny data set and trained only for 10 epochs. So the result is not very impressive. But you know that the code works and it gives a result. You also get some additional data like this evaluation of Hausdorff distance, chamfer distance, and such things. Let's check the code. Feel free to interrupt me if anything is unclear. Okay, so I've showed already data sets, experiments. Okay, some basics. So it's except for the shell script, it's just Python code using PyTorch with TensorBoard. In case you didn't know, you can use TensorBoard without TensorFlow. Those experiment scripts look like this one. So it actually just calls the fulltrain.py. And this fulltrain is here on the root directory. And actually this one just calls the points to serve train. And here's where the fun begins. So we have here some setup parameters. We have logging. This is for console output and tensor board. Some setup code. We have experimented with different kinds of features, like for example, predicting the SDF in one step, so only one regression, but this classification for the sign and regression for the absolute distance was better. Then, yeah, some additional stuff for data throughput, I would say. Here we create the model, I'll show you later. Here we create a data set and data sampler and all the stuff. PyTorch gives you base classes for it. different sampling strategies. So the usual strategy is to pick to go through the meshes one by one, but for the SDF samples of each mesh, we take only 2,000 randomly per epoch, although we have like 10,000 available. So the reason for this is going from mesh to mesh is just memory efficiency, because there's well, this data sampler has several workers that will go in parallel, and we have a cache that caches the training data, and this is on a per shape basis. But within the shape, so the SDF samples per shape are random, so doesn't matter for efficiency. I think there's a question. Okay.
I think no.
Thanks for enjoying.
I will say this is where the fun starts. I'm gonna use that sentence on. I think when you mentioned that this is where we started training up in the function. I was joking. We started this part of the code with "this is where the fun starts."
Yeah.
it's a nice way to start it. Actually, I liked it.
Okay. Optimize scheduler. I guess most of you know it anyway, so I can skip probably many parts. Here we go through the data set enumerated from the data loader. Here is the call to the model. We get an output, compute the loss, get backward propagation. And sometimes we do essentially the same without backprop to get the test loss. That's more or less it for the training. Here is the loss function. It's just referring to actually something a bit different. So here, this is the interesting loss function that we used in the paper. So we have here this magnitude loss, so the absolute distance to the surface. So that's, of course, absolute. And then with the tangus hyperpolicus, we focus the loss essentially on the lower values. And then get the mean square error on top. And that's our loss for the absolute distance. And for the sign, it's just PyTorch binary cross entropy with logits. So not too much fancy from my side. Some metrics. As I said, I also have F1 score and so on for logging and the training. That helped a lot for many things. Then I guess you're mostly interested in the network here and the model. So it's more or less copied from PCPNet from Paul. So we have a spatial transformer network. I think this is completely unchanged, maybe even unused. the quaternion spatial transformer network, as I said, which is meant to rotate the point clouds to canonical poles. It outputs a quaternion. Then we have this feature network, which turns the point cloud into a feature vector. I think it's also just copy-pasted from PCPNet, which is essentially a point net. So you can imagine you have many points, and you have those accumulation parts for those points. And then you more or less cut slices into those accumulation parts. And this gives you this order invariance that we need for point clouds, because, well, it's a set of points and we have no influence of the order. So we absolutely need this a symmetric operation that gives us this order independence. And then this is the actual model. That's still quite close to PCPNet, where we basically assemble those subnetworks from above, and also different variants. So I had a single transformer where both point clouds went into, and we got only one feature vector. But the typical one is the one with two feature transformers. Yeah, so one for the global subset, one for the local subset. And this part below, this is the multi-layer perceptron where we put in the concatenated feature vectors. Then, the forward code, it's straightforward. here is a debugging code. I would really recommend you to do something similar. It helped me a lot. So this gives me a visualization of a single patch that actually went into the network. So I had several bugs that appeared through all this data sampler, data loader, pre-processing, whatever. But at this step, I could really see if it's correct or not. Some more parts of the network. So the multi-layer perceptron in the end. Good. So that's it for the model. Then one short remark about the evaluation or reconstruction. So as I showed, our training samples are more or less randomly distributed around the mesh, but the evaluation is actually in the grid, or at least in parts of the grid. As I said earlier, those voxels that are near the point cloud. So the data set for evaluation is a bit different. But otherwise, it's quite close. We have reconstruction here. We have evaluation of the reconstruction. Let's Okay, one interesting part is maybe, what is it? No, not this. Okay, so this is this part of the code where I get the query points for the reconstruction. So points near the surface, near the samples, near the point cloud. So this, okay. So then we have this implicit surface to mesh. This calls the sign propagation. So as I said, we evaluate only the voxels near the point cloud. So we need to propagate the sign from those values. And yeah, that can take a few seconds, up to a minute, I think. And afterwards, we have a complete grid full of values, full of SDF values. And then we can call matching cubes. In this case, it's the variant of SK image, so scikit image. And it's the Levina variant of matching cubes, which gives us vertices, faces, also normals, which I didn't use, and values, I think the interpolation values or something. And with this information, I can create a mesh, use the tree mesh library. And I need to fix the inversion for some reason and can export the reconstructed mesh here. So, then, I guess the last interesting part is probably dataset generation with point cloud sampling. So for dataset generation, we have two files. This MacPC dataset is a simplified version that basically converts a raw point cloud. It gives some normalization and so on, and gives us something to reconstruct. But for training, we need a bit more. So that's why we need this file. It's not too nice, the code, but it works. We have a fixed radius for, do we? No. I think this is a bit outdated, probably not used anymore. So we take the raw inputs from the ABC dataset, converted, use PLY. It's very nice, has every information I need, and compressed. Then some cleaning, or more accurately, throwing out all meshes that are not very clean. Then normalization to unit cube, and then the sampling with Blensor. So for Blensor, you need to download the Blensor binary. It's essentially a plugin for Blender. You might know Blender for modeling, rendering. Blender has, of course, a ray tracing part, path tracing. And Blensor uses this ray tracing to simulate rays of the scanners. So then we create here files, so scripts for Blensor that run in the Blender Python scripting language. So it has slightly different libraries available. And this template I fill with different parameters like the number of scans. And also the location of the scanner, the noise strength, different settings, and of course the mesh that I want to turn into a point cloud. And then I call Blensor with this script file and also in parallel. So all steps of this dataset generation are working as worker processes. Well, this template for the Blensor script looks like this. So we have Blender Python imports on the top, then import Blensor. So you, when you download Blensor, you have a Blender distribution and some additional Blensor code. So you need to import Blensor. Then here some variables with placeholders. So I take this file as a string and replace those placeholders with my actual information. So like the input and output files and the scanner position and noise strength and such things. And then we fill in, use the Blensor, create a simple scene with the with an object and a scanner. And then, for each scan, so we do like 5 to 30 scans. For each scan, we call the Blensor scanner with certain parameters. In this case, it was a time of flight scanner. So it's based on a real world scanner. And you can give it like view port or resolution. And as we, as an output, we that's just the definition of the function, and actually for each scan we do this. So that's it for the scanning. And there are two last steps for the dataset generation. So after the point cloud sampling, we still need the ground truth data for the training. So here we create the SDF samples, and afterwards we create the dataset split. So training set and test set. Query points, a lot of tree mesh used, not a lot of my own code. Random sampling of the points and getting the sign distance using tree mesh. That's it. I think I've covered the most important part of the code. Do you have any more questions?
I think no. No. Also, we are not a lot left because we're a bit past of time, but it's good. Sorry. It's okay. Because most of the audience watches the recording anyways. They will have chapters and there will be the part for the code and part for the talk. So it's good.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. We could wrap up, Philip, or is there anything more?
No, I think that's it.
Perfect. So we have a couple of references from you that we would like. I actually wanted to ask you to send us your YouTube channel. I'll write it in the description so people can, in the beginning of the talk, you mentioned you have a small YouTube channel with your research group. So that, and the list of algorithms that are similar to marching cubes, including the spin-offs of marching cubes, the one that you are familiar with and you could recommend. And if they have an open source, if you could also send me a link to their open source, and I'll add it also in the recordings description. I will add chapters to it, so we'll have the entire talk segmented, so people can jump into the right sections, including the code part. And for those who stayed before, thank you for being. Those who are going to watch the recording, thanks that you're with us, and we can wrap it up. Philip, thank you so much for the very elaborate talk. That slide that you had with the different parts, with the different research and point cloud to implicit fields and then to very spot on. If that's okay, I might want to use it sometimes. I'll write it as yours, but it's a very good one. Very useful.
Used some images that might have copyright.
Yeah, on that slide.
No, I think it's okay. One is from the Kinect Fusion paper and one is from Wikipedia. One I made in Portree and one is just Google image search. Maybe the paper one could be problematic.
Okay, so it doesn't have to be, but I could refer people to it, so it's also good.
I mean, I can give it to you, of course. What you do is your thing.
Yeah, I know. No worries. So, Philip, thank you a lot. And
thanks
with this,
for inviting me.
Thank you. And with this, we'll close, and I'll say good evening to you and good day to everybody. Bye for now.